Have you stand up? We're going to start off today singing our way into worship. Good one to start us off with. So, good morning. How's everybody surviving this heat? It feels like home to me, right? You never hear me complain about the heat, but we're so glad that you're in sanctuary with us or out online. Welcome. We're Bethany Church, the most welcoming church around.
Amen.
I think so. We're going to continue worship now. As you all know, we do kind of blended music here. So, we went from an older song into a more contemporary song. Now, this is an old contemporary song, but it's still contemporary, so. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross, and I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross, and I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Very nice. So before I send you off to greet your friends, we do have a birthday coming up here this coming Saturday. Where's Miss Judy? I hear it's your birthday. Happy birthday, Miss Judy. So let's all do, what'd she say? Oh, Miss Judy, are you kidding me? We were just talking about before the service how we all hope, I have no idea how old you are because we can't tell. You look that good. So anyway, let's do a quick little happy birthday for Miss Judy.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Excellent. Now you can go greet your neighbor.
Good morning, Bethany boys and girls. Oh, come on up. I see a few of you here. Woo. Okay, come on up. Here, would you like one? There you go. Have a seat. Ellie, you want to sit next to me? Maybe your friend's a little shy. Okay. Hi, Lily Joe. I see that. It's gnome stickers. I like gnomes. I have a couple gnomes in my yard, actually.
Well, Mama has a lot of gnomes.
A lot of gnomes. Okay. Well, you know, some of you are in school yet. Some of you aren't quite yet. But you know, in PE, and I know everybody probably in this room has experienced that, when you go to play a game, and I brought a couple balls with me today. Show them what those are. I'm trying to think cold. Turn them around. There we go. Woo! I'm sorry. They're snowballs, yeah. Makes you cool off a little, right? Yep. What? I'm sorry.
With snowmen.
It was snowman faces, yes, exactly. But when you're in PE, you know how they choose teams? And sometimes the most popular kids or the ones that are the best athletes are chosen first. Yeah, and then sometimes you feel left out, and I know members of our congregation have probably felt that. Well, there's another way to choose, and it's you just number off. I've done this in my classroom, but I've always seen the kids, too, kind of move around so they get where they want to be. And, you know, it goes one, two, one, two, one, two.
Hi, Miss Susie.
Hi, Ellie. Well, you know what? That's a couple ways to choose a team. But that's not the way that God chooses. He chooses, and this is to be part of his family. Would you like to be part of God's family?
Yes.
Say that again emphatically.
Yes.
Yes. Would you like to be part of God's family?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. That's a great. Well, God chooses his family differently than they do there in PE class. He chooses it when you believe that Jesus is your Savior.
Yes.
Yes, there is. You put it on you. This is what he says about it. It comes from Ephesians 1, verses 4 and 5. This is what he says. For he chose us in him. You hear the word chose. He chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will. He chose us. No one's left out. No one's left behind. Just remember that. You are chosen. Let's pray this morning. Dear Lord, I thank you for these children. We ask that you bless each one of them, those that are here and those that couldn't be here this morning. We ask that you be with them and help them remember that they are indeed chosen, chosen by you. In all your love, amen.
Good morning. As always, may the peace and love of our Lord and Savior rest on each and every one of you. I would be remiss this morning if I did not mention the horrific and ignominious events of yesterday. I had written my prayer before any of that took place, so I'm not going to change that. But what I would ask is that we keep all of those who were affected by what happened yesterday, especially the families of those who are going through an impossible time. Please keep them in your prayers. Let's bow our heads and prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Mighty God, King of kings, Lord of lords, we glorify your holy name by lifting you up above all things, in all places, and at all times. You are the God who gives and the God who takes away, the God who brings sunlight and the God who brings rain, the God of vengeance and the God of redemption, the God who heals the sick and the God who raises the dead, the God who saves and the God who gives eternal life. How blessed are we to have you in our lives, to have been chosen by you before the foundation of the world. We give our utmost thanks for our election and for the unending blessings you pour out to us so freely. Forgive us for our sins and help us to conform to your word and your way. This morning, we come before you with all of our weaknesses, with all of our moral frailty, and with all of our shattered brokenness. Do not allow us to become naive in thinking that our security lies in our material possessions or in the wisdom of human hands, for we know these things are merely temporal and not eternal. Instead, help us to place our complete trust, faith, and confidence in you and in you alone. Teach us to seek your counsel first before ever making a decision, even in things we deem as trivial. For only your wisdom, guidance, and providential hand are capable of setting us on the one and true righteous path. We come to you today, Lord, asking prayers for all believers, prayers for the world, our nation, our state, and our community. We offer prayers for the sick, the downtrodden, the widow, and the orphan. May all seek your counsel first before ever taking any kind of action. We also ask for a special prayer for our children, and specifically our youth group, as they travel in witness on their mission trip. Please watch over them, Lord, with constant vigilance and guidance, for they represent hope for the world and are your servants of tomorrow. We ask all of this in the name of our blessed Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Will you please stand? We have to now do our song that will lead us into worship.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. Before our Father's throne, we pour our ardent prayers. Our fears, our hopes, our aims are one.
You've probably noticed that Pastor Steve is not here today, right? He's on the mission trip with our youth, so we don't have Savannah and Parker and Cassidy. None of them are with us. They're gone. But never fear, we're in good hands. He has sent his dear friend, Carman Wuebbels, who is an associate pastor at Christ Church and also an ordained elder in the Global Methodist Church, to deliver our message for us today. So let's give Carman a warm Bethany welcome.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. Well, what an honor it is to be here this morning. As she said, my name is Carman. If you're joining us online, welcome. We're so glad you're here with us to worship. This is this too close? I apologize if so, and Kay, if Steve comes home with a different color lipstick than you're used to on, it's probably mine on his microphone, just so you know. Will you stand for the reading of God's Word? We are in Acts, the second chapter today. We'll start at verse 42. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day, the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God. Amen. You may be seated. Let's see, I may run out of room here. I don't know. Well, again, it is a great honor to be with you. Just a little bit about my background. I have been in healthcare for over 40 years. I started when I was 4, just so you know. But I was ready to retire, and as part of my retirement, I started working at Christ Church as their faith community nurse coordinator, our parish nurse, just as you have here. And God called me, kept calling me deeper into the ministry. And so I eventually became a licensed pastor through the UMC. And then God took me through seminary, praise God. And God just continues to ask us to go deeper, right? And I think the most important part is that we are obedient, because when we are not obedient, we will not be happy. So that is the reason that I am here today, is in a walk of obedience. So great honor to be here. I'm going to put my glasses on. They serve really a couple of purposes, and that is because I can't read my manuscript without them, but they also help you because I can't see you well with them on. And so if you're not smiling and you're frowning, it's okay. We're in the book of Acts today. This book is said to have been written by Luke, a physician and a companion of Paul. And we actually are in Jerusalem. That's where our story is. And it's between the early 60s AD and the mid 80s AD. And Jesus had been crucified, buried, resurrected, and ascended into heaven. And Pentecost had arrived, and Holy Spirit fire had rained down upon the only 120 Christians in the world. And they were empowered with gifts to carry out the ministry of Christ. Peter preached under the influence of the Holy Spirit, and 3,000 people became part of the church that day. 3,000 people. Our scripture today shows us a picture of the early church, a church that was growing and a church that was unified. The early church was formed around four practices and eight characteristics. And we saw those four practices in verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, fellowship, sharing in communion, and prayer. And then the eight characteristics of the church we see in verses 43 through 47. There's wonder and miracles, and there was fellowship and generosity, and there was worship, a time of communion, and the church began to develop a good reputation, and there was growth. But today I want to focus on worship. If you were to ask 10 people what worship is, what do you think they would say? Most of them would probably say something about singing in church, right? And it makes sense, because that's how we start our services here. We divide our services into music and worship in that way, and then we move into biblical teaching. And I got to tell you guys, I was blessed by the worship team this morning. The way that they do the old and the new together, I love that. You guys are very blessed to have them. But the reality is that worship is so much more than great music. And if we want to honor God, we need to understand the nature of true worship, right? The Greek word for worship is, and this is the only time I'll talk Greek, I promise. The Greek word for worship is proskuneo, and it means to fall before or to bow down before, to prostrate oneself or to lay flat, face down on the ground, in reverence and in submission. I do a lot of guest preaching, actually, and for a while there was two churches in Southern Illinois. And they didn't, it's a two-point charge. They did not have a pastor. They had left the denomination, the UMC denomination, and so during that interim, I was going fairly frequently. One of the churches was a church of about 90 to 100 folks. And the other church was this small country church that looked like we were meeting in someone's house, and there was about 25 or 30 members there. And I remember one day being there, and I was just getting ready to finish my sermon, and God said, "Give an altar call." And I said, in my mind, "All right, God, how do you plan to do that? Because where I was standing at the altar was about this big. You could fit a podium and a piano, And I'm not talking a grand piano. I'm talking an upright piano. And I literally could lean on the piano as I was preaching. That's how small the altar was. And I thought, God, there's no way for them to come. Where are they going to come to? And God said, Carmen, stop. Get out of my way for once. Just do what I'm asking you to do. And so I did. I prayed. I invited them to come to the altar. I went and I kneeled at the seat, the front pew, and I kneeled there and I began to pray. And when I got off my knees and I looked, there was no one sitting in a pew anywhere. They had not only made their way to the altar, but there were people praying in the aisle, face down in the aisle. And I had to say to myself, I know that day that God was pleased with their worship to him. And, you know, it's amazing the work that God will do if we just allow him. But it was so awesome to see them really give everything that they had to worship. It was so cool to see them as they poured out everything to Jesus. Because you see, worship is when we give our deepest affection and our highest praise to God. Did you know that worship is the only thing that you can give God that he's not given you? I'm going to say that one more time. Our worship to God is the only thing that we can give him that he hasn't already given us. He gave us life, and he gives us everything to sustain our lives. He's given us love and food and water, our health and wealth. He answers our prayers. And in response, we are to give him our worship, right? And worship's not merely just a ritual or a routine. It's a sacred journey of the heart. It's this divine encounter with an almighty God. Worship at its core is an expression of our reverence and our love and our devotion to God. It's an intimate communion with the creator of the universe. It's this holy exchange where we offer ourselves wholeheartedly to him. As we meet this morning for corporate worship, I know that God is pleased. But friends, worship goes beyond this. It is not just worship in the four walls of the church. Worship should be 7 days a week. The biblical definition of worship is when we love God with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. And it's when we put God first in our hearts and our lives. And that comes from Deuteronomy. Here's what it says, 6th chapter, verse 4 through 5. Listen, O Israel, the Lord is our God, and the Lord alone. And you must love your God with all your heart, and all your soul, and all your strength. But listen what also it says in the scripture, and this comes from Matthew 15, verses 8 through 9. It says, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship is a farce. This explains clearly that our worship is about our heart and being right with God and giving our all to God. True worship involves surrendering ourselves completely to God, laying down our burdens, our fears, and our desires at his feet. It requires us to be vulnerable, doesn't it? And authentic. And it requires that we allow God to work in and through us and mold us into the vessels of grace and love that he wants us to be. Worship is this continual outpouring of everything that I am and everything that I do. It's total submission and obedience. And it's when I focus my attention and my affection humbly before God because of his greatness and who he is. It's to know God truly and to respond with my whole heart, soul, and everything that is within me. Worship is a theme that we see throughout scriptures, from Genesis to Revelation. Someone said to me a couple of weeks ago, I finished preaching at Fairview Heights, and they said, I'm not sure yet if I like the way you generally take us in scripture from the beginning to the end of the Bible. I said, really? Because that's the way the story goes, right? But they're still trying to figure out if they like that or not. But it really does. Worship is this theme that we see from Genesis to Revelation, and we're going to go through some of that. It's an attitude that comes from the inside out, and the scripture tells us we must worship in spirit and truth. John, the fourth chapter, in verse 23, it says, but the time is coming, indeed is here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. God is a spirit, and he's present everywhere, and he can be worshiped everywhere and anywhere and at any time. Where we worship him is not important, but it's how we worship him that is important. And it's that act of obedience to his request for worship that is important. So let me ask you this, church. Are you putting your whole heart, soul, and strength into your worship? And is your worship genuine and true? And are you worshiping God in spirit and in truth? Or are you just going through the motions? We need to remind ourselves that worship is an encounter with the living and holy God. Worship is an integral part of our relationship with him. When we worship, we're expressing love and gratitude and awe. The very act of bowing down and kneeling shows that we recognize that he is sovereign and shows that we have a heart that is humble and we're surrendering to his supreme authority and that we acknowledge his greatness. And we're also acknowledging our need for him, right? When I was in seminary, we studied a book. And the name of the book was Worship is a Verb. Has anybody ever heard of that book? I had not until I went to seminary. But worship is a verb. What does that mean? It's active. We should be doing something, right? It's not passive. Do we have any baseball fans in here? Yeah, okay. And I heard some of you stayed late last night and made it to the last play, and what a game it was, right? Well, I've been several times this year. The last one was Friday night. I'm a Cardinals fan. Cardinals fans, yes? Yeah, all right. Cubs fans? Oh, dear. Oh, dear. Oh, dear. I feel like we're split down the middle here. Well, I was dressed out in all my Cardinals gear and rooting on my team. And even when they started not to do well, I continued to root on my team. When I go, I am all in. And I'm yelling and doing the wave and singing with the crowd. And that's what our worship should be like, right? When's the last time you gave that much effort to your worship? But sometimes our worship is like we're all Cubs fans, and like they were last night, right? Nobody, not a lot of people smiling, not a lot of people clapping, not a lot of folks cheering. That's what I feel like our worship can be like sometimes. When we come to church, and when not just when we come to church, but when we worship, this should be a time when we are focused on the one who loves us the most. To the one that created us, the one that woke us up this morning, right? When worship is really good, the music becomes background noise. It becomes background noise. I like to go to the 8 o'clock service at our church. It's not quite as populated, so I can have a seat to myself most days. Isn't that terrible? I need a seat to myself. Maybe I shouldn't admit that. You weren't filming that, were you? But I do. I like to go and sit in the very back and just worship with abandon and raise my hands and worship God. And many times, it's just him and I in that room. When I focus on him in worship, it's just him and me in that room. And I know it seems weird and it seems funny to some. My husband's not one that raises his hands in worship, and that's okay. But I remember the first time that I began to worship with full abandon. And I was at one of the lowest times in my life. And the Holy Spirit got a hold of me. And my worship changed from a time of singing and just checking the box to a daily time of praise and glory to a God that gave his son for me, although he knew that I would disappoint him. Psalms 100, verse 2 through 3. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his people and the sheep of his pasture. This psalm reminds us that we're made to serve and to worship the Lord with joy and thanksgiving. Psalms 95:6 says, O come, let us worship and bow down, and let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. This verse encourages us to bow down and worship the Lord. It emphasizes humility and reverence that we should have towards God our Creator. Isaiah 43:7 says, Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, and whom I formed and made. This verse reminds us that we're created for God's glory, and our purpose is to glorify him through our worship and our service. Colossians 1:16 says, For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. This verse emphasizes that not only were we created by God, but everything that exists was created through him and for him. It's a reminder that our worship and service to God is part of his ultimate plan, isn't it? Revelation 4 through 11. See, we made it. Y'all didn't think we'd make it, did you? Revelation 4, 11. Worthy are you, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and they exist because you created what you pleased. This verse is a declaration of worship to God. Of worship to God as the creator of all things. It recognizes God's authority and power as the one who brought everything into existence. These are just a few scriptures that really talk to us about worship. Did you realize that worship began in the Garden of Eden, but it was interrupted by the fall? The first mention of the word worship in the Bible is in Genesis 22 and verse 5, and it says this, Stay here with the donkey, Abraham told the servants. The boy and I will travel a little farther, and we will worship there, and then we'll come right back. You know the story. Abraham's act of worship was to willingly surrender his son Isaac, who he loved dearly. No band, no microphones, no worship team, no music. There was two people at that worship service, a father and a son, and an altar. Abraham truly demonstrated obedience and a profound act of worship and submission. Worship, it's obedience to God. It's less about the song or the service. It's less about the team. And those things are important. Don't get me wrong. But like the story of Abraham and his son, our worship is more about the altar. Romans 12, 1 through 2 says this, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be living and a holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Give him your all." If anybody takes notes, I'm going to give you 6 ways to worship God daily. And you know these, I'm sure, but sometimes we just need to be reminded. The first thing that we need to do is to start our day in prayer. Has anyone fallen into the technology trap? Anyone in here? Oh, come on. Do you wake up every morning and pick up the phone first thing? Of course you do, because that's where our alarms are now, right? So we pick up the phone. And if you're like me, I think, and I'm on call 24/7 for Christ Church. And I think, you know, I might have missed a phone call or a text, so I begin to check. And I look at the text, and I think, oh, I should probably answer that right away, because now that I've opened it, I may forget to go back. And so I begin answering some texts, and then I move on to emails. And I have 4 email accounts, y'all. I have my personal one, Christ Church. I still work very part-time for Barnes Jewish corporate office. And then I have Asbury, because I'm in their doctorate program there. And so I have 4 email accounts. And I begin to go through the emails. And I start to answer them because I think, well, that person is in need of help, and they probably would like an answer right away. And so I began to answer those. And before you know it, I got up early to pray and to worship. And that time is gone. And I've started my day already before I even started my worship. One of the girls in my accountability group, I don't know if you all have accountability groups, but they are so good. They don't have to be big, just something small. But we need to hold each other accountable for scripture and walking a Christian life. But she said, I noticed I was doing the same thing, and I am making it my priority first thing in the morning not to touch the phone first thing. So I am really working on it, y'all, really working on it, to shut the alarm off and to leave the phone sit so that I can give God the first part of my day. Proverbs 3:6 says it this way, "In everything you do, put God first, and he will direct you and crown your efforts with success." Number 2, pray intentionally. It's so easy to say a quick prayer to check the box, but we should be intentional about spending time in prayer. You know, of course, God wants to hear everything that is going on in our lives, and he wants us to confess our sins and repent. But remember, a big part of our prayer life should be to praise and to worship him. Number 3, read and study the scripture. Study being the key word here. I can't tell you, I grew up in the church. I was 8 when I accepted Jesus as my Savior, and I will tell you, I was older before I ever really started studying the Bible. Oh, I knew all the stories, and I could tell you the stories, but to really sit and read the Bible and find out exactly what it is that God's trying to say to me. And I will tell you, today, I may read one scripture, and I may study I may read one verse and study that entire verse for a week or even longer, just trying to see what it is that God wants me to get from that. Joshua 1:18 says, "Keep this book of law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful." How can we do it if we don't know what's written in it, right? So we need to study God's word. And we can start by asking these questions. What is the promise in the scripture that God wants me to see? What is the lesson that I should learn? Is there a command in this scripture that I am to obey? And what is the sin that I am to avoid? Or is there a change I need to make in my attitude? Is there a change I need to make in my behavior and in my life? Really start to study the scripture and apply it to your life. Number four, write down things that you're thankful for and keep the list with you. And let it remind you throughout the day to worship and to give praise. I think we're good at talking to God about things that are going on in our lives, but we forget to list all those things that he's already blessing us with, right? So make a list of those things that you are thankful for. 1 Chronicles 16:34 tells us to give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Number five, turn your complaints into praise. We are complainers. I got to tell you, I'm just being transparent, y'all. Pastors are not perfect. Before the service, I was having a conversation back here, and I began to complain, and I said, my goodness, complaining is in my sermon today, and I'm complaining. So it's easy to do, but work on turning your complaints into praise. We're really good complainers. We complain about even the smallest of things, and we share our complaints because, well, I think we figure that everybody else should hear our complaints, right? Guilty as charged, I am. But try this. When you start to complain about something, take a second and turn it into a praise. Ephesians 4:29 says, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen." So turn your complaints into praise and worship and be thankful. Number six, glorify God in whatever you do. 1 Corinthians 10:31. "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." This verse reminds us that our worship is not limited to specific activities or times of the day. We're called to glorify God in everything we do, recognizing that everything about our lives should be a form of worship to him, because that's the reason he created us. Have you ever thought that when we worship, we're experiencing a glimpse of heaven? Revelation 5, verse 12 through 13 says this, "Saying with a loud voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and honor and glory and blessing.' And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea. And they sang, 'Blessing and honor and glory and power belong to the one sitting on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever.'" These verses emphasize the fact that all creatures will ultimately recognize the greatness of God and worship him. Do you remember the story of Job? The story of Job shows how worship to God can sustain a person through any adversity. Job was rich and famous, and he lost it all. He lost all of his possessions. He lost his children. He lost his own health. But he still refused to curse God. And in fact, watch what he does. Job stood up and tore his robe in grief. And then he shaved his head and he fell to the ground to worship. He said, "I come naked from my mother's womb, and I will be naked when I leave. The Lord gave me what I had, and the Lord has taken it away. Praise the name of the Lord." Job's grieving, and yet he worships. How many of us today are grieving? Maybe the loss of a loved one, the loss of our health, a wayward child, a career that's not going well, loss of a marriage, loss of the way things used to be, or maybe we're grieving for the way we thought things would be, the way we thought things would turn out, and they didn't. Worship is the best way to heal. Worship is the best way to deal with brokenness and dysfunction and the dreams that never came true. It's okay to have questions. It's okay to have our whys. But don't let that stop you from worship. Job had a lot of questions, but he fell and worshiped. In the scripture, when God visits Job, he didn't answer any of his questions. In fact, he had more questions for Job, right? If you think you have questions, just wait till God asks you some questions. But at the end of it all, the Bible says that God, what'd he do? Restored everything that Satan stole from Job. He restored it all. From the story of Job, you can sum that up in a few words. God's not guilty of doing anything but loving us. Satan is not innocent. He's a liar, and he wants to rob us of everything good that God gives us. And you are not worthy of anything. But because God gave his only son as an atonement for our sin, we are made worthy by the life, death, and the resurrection of Jesus. And folks, he is worthy of our worship and praise. You can choose not to worship, or you can worship and let God walk you through every dark valley without being afraid. And you, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, can be in the fire, but never be burned. And like Daniel, you can be in the lion's den and never be harmed if you choose to worship. The scripture tells us that Job fell down and worshiped. When you don't have the answers, and when you don't get the answers you want, worship God anyway. Get on your knees before God that is worthy of our worship and our praise. Worship him and trust him to do the rest. Abraham took his only son, Isaac, whom he loved. And he went, it says in the scripture, he went to worship. He trusted God. He was obedient to God. And Isaac wants to know, what are we giving to God? And what did God do? God gave him a ram, right? Worship God in the hard times. If you read Job in the second chapter, his life got even worse. Job had no idea what was going on, but he worshiped. And the scripture said, or scripture says, but God. Say it with me. But God. One more time. You can do better than that. But God. But God restored it all. Do you need to be restored today? Are you looking for God to restore you? Worship him. You say, but Pastor Carman, you have no idea what I have done. You have no idea what I have been through, what I'm going through. No, you're right. I don't. But God does. Worship God and watch God come on the scene and do great and mighty things that you could never imagine. Y'all, life is messy. It's messy for all of us. Problems with our families, our children, finances, aging parents. It's messy. But if we'll focus on Jesus and worship him, we'll find that he fixes everything. When is the last time that you fell on your face in worship and totally surrendered to God? I invite you to try that today. We are going to go into a time of prayer right now. If you feel like you want to come and worship at the altar, come and worship at the altar. If you want to worship in your seat, worship in your seat. I'm going to ask the musicians to come forward. Pray with me. Gracious Heavenly Father, we love you. Father, thank you for loving us. Father, thank you that you loved us so much that you sent your Son, Jesus. We give you thanks for that. Father, we're sorry that we don't worship you and praise you like we should. Father, we ask you to lead and guide us today and help us to do that. Help us to do that in a manner that is pleasing to you. And Father, as we come to a time of giving of our tithes and offerings here, may we be reminded that the scripture tells us that generosity is a part of our worship. Father, thank you for the gifts that will be given today. I pray that you will multiply them to reach people for your kingdom. And we'll give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is a video that we were supposed to play last week. It's from Trinity Global Methodist Church. And that's who our kids are off with on their mission trip. So. All right, that should be a great experience for our youth. Will you all stand for the doxology?
Praise to the King, his throne transcends, his crown and kingdom never end, now and throughout eternity. Praise the one who died for me. Amen.
Okay, and now as Pastor Steve always says, we're going to sing our way out. Before we do, we want to thank Pastor Carman for delivering such a wonderful message. We're so thankful that you were here today. And remember this week, guys, while you're out there worshiping this week, we have a lot of people in our church who need your prayers. Lauren has the prayer list. If you don't know who we're talking about, there's a lot of people who are in and out of the hospital right now. So please keep them all in your prayers. And our country, we're in some difficult times. So just be thinking about that during the week. And now let's stand. We're going to do some clapping, going back to a more contemporary Matt Maher song.
Afraid, you're not the only, we are all the same, in need of mercy, to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to leave. lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Whoa, 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 whoa. And all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is all we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. And he so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 oh. And all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another start. For theirs is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 oh. And all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen.
One more time through.
And all the people said amen. Whoa, 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 whoa. And all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen.
Have a great